Evening, gang. It's Sunday, the 19th of March, 2017. Welcome along to today's United Kingdom Talk. Well, to be honest, it was going to be you or Beauty and the Beast tonight. I had a little sleep this afternoon. I got up and thought, oh, you know, I really want to go and see that film Beauty and the Beast. Has anyone seen that yet? La da da da. I hope that song's in it. Till the test of time. Off to the cupboard with you now, Chip. And that little cup goes walking along. I hope that song's in it. I should be bitterly disappointed. Apparently, there are lots of new songs in it. I don't know how much of the original cartoon sort of features and songs will remain in the live show. I'd be interested to see that. But here I am talking to you instead. I could catch a late film. And the latest, they don't seem to have many late films on a Sunday. The latest being about 9:15. And what is it now? 20 to 8, 20 to 9. Oh, it's pushing it a bit as well. It's pushing it a bit. Mind you, haven't had dinner yet. Well, I had lunch. I haven't had dinner because it's been a bit of a busy day today. And the reason it was a bit is busy day today is because the blooming act last night, I was working at Central Station last night, and 10:30 is show time. No, it's not time for me. I start at 9:30 there on a Saturday night, and the show is supposed to go on at 10:30, and 99 times out of 100, it does go on at 10:30. Well, they didn't get there till 10 o'clock, till 11 o'clock. Oh, I'm stuck in traffic. Come on, boys. It can't be that bad. I got there with no traffic problems at all last night. Anyway, so the artists didn't go on till I think it was 25 to 12. I'm supposed to finish at 12. My God, you know what I'm like at work. 12 o'clock. If I finish at 12, I'm in that car at 2 minutes past. End of the job. Done. You know what I mean? We haven't got time to hang around having drinks and things. No, job done. Goodbye. In the car. So, of course, the show went on at 25 to 12. It was an excellent show. But I didn't get out until, it must have been 1 o'clock. I think it was about 10 past one by the time I got out. Now, I'm kind of a little bit time desperate on Saturdays and Sundays. And the reason is, I get home. That wasn't easy because there were roads closed everywhere. Foolishly, last night, I was going along the Euston Road to go home. And flashed up on my little screen something like a 4 minute delay, which is nothing. But that 4 minute delay along the Euston Road can become a 10 minute delay. So I thought, well, I'll try and avoid it. And I went left. Ah, big mistake that was. Down Regent Street through Piccadilly, and of course you got all the drunkards coming out of the clubs and what have you at 1 o'clock. It's about 1:30, 1:15, 1:30 in the morning now. So I got caught up in all that, and I didn't get home until I think it was about 2:40 in the end. I didn't get to bed till about 2:40. I got home about 2:30, which was a long drive home. You know, stuck in traffic, as always in London. Part of the M4 was closed, and you just kept bumping into closed roads all the time. I don't understand why they have to do them all at the same time. And it's generally on a Saturday night. The drive home on the Saturday night is usually the worst one. The drive in on the Friday night is the worst one in, or the Wednesday. The Wednesday or the Friday in, and the Friday and the Saturday out. Anyway, so I got to bed about 2:30. Now, usually on a Saturday, I'll get up at 7:30 in the morning to go to church. But that's assuming I get in at about 1:15, 1:30. And I thought, you know, if I set the alarm to go off 4 hours later or whatever it is, I'm going to be ill all day. Because I've done that before. Many times, the funny thing is, 7:30 comes, the alarm goes off. And in your head, You're already set and you're worrying about this alarm going off at 7:30 and you can't get to sleep. I've done that before. You ever done that? Set the alarm for early on and you can't get to sleep because you're worried that you're going to sleep through the alarm because it's going off in just a few hours' time. So I thought, well, I won't set the alarm. So I won't get up at 7:30. If I wake up at 7:30, all well and good, I can go to my usual church and that. But, you know, so I went to sleep. I woke up 8:10. 8:10, which is only 40 minutes later, but it doesn't give me enough time to have a cup of tea and a little bit to eat before I jump on my bicycle and cycle to church, which is about 25 minutes into Wokingham, you see. So I sat down and I thought, right, I'm not going to rush this. I'll go somewhere else today. So I did. I went somewhere else today. Ascot. Oh, very posh there, dear. Now, I haven't been to this particular church before. It was St. Francis in Ascot. So I set my sat-nav at 15 minutes and I noticed it was a 10 o'clock mass. So I got in my car, I ran about, I think it was about 20 past nine. I left a bit earlier because I hadn't been there before, you know, so you don't exactly know where it is. So I set the sat-nav, you know, Coronation Road in Ascot. And I'm driving along, you know, at a reasonable speed, and I found the road and turned into it. Oh, my word, you want to see this road and the houses down there. Great big gates, electric gates and all this. Massive houses down there. There's got to be one or two very famous people living along that road, I reckoned. I wondered if any one of them turned up in a church. Because you don't know. Anyway, there was a very big car park in there. And got out of the car and went in, walked up. I go straight up the middle and usually second row back, I sit. You don't want to sit at the front. I was a bit disappointed to see. Do you know, I think I was the only celebrity in there. Yes, I was the only star. Isn't that funny? I thought there'd be one or two, you know, big stars in there. I don't know. Someone along the lines of Bruce Forsyth, Cilla Black, someone like that. You know, obviously Cilla wouldn't be there again, would she? But no, I think I was the only star in there. Isn't that amazing? Isn't that amazing? It really is. So I found somewhere to sit, and this little elderly lady said, "Did anyone sit here?" She said, "No, no, come in." And I sat down, and immediately we start talking. And there's a little choir. No organ, though. Disappointingly, no organ. Only a piano. They had a piano, a technics piano, playing away. And they were rehearsing. Some woman had a screechy voice. There's always one of them, isn't there? Someone with a screechy voice. But there were two people. There was an elderly gentleman. No, not elderly. Middle-aged gentleman, about the same age as me. He was playing the flute. Ooh, but he was slightly out of key. I could tell my musical ear indicated that if she was playing the piano and it was ever so slight, but nevertheless, he was definitely not playing exactly the same note as the keyboard player, who was a woman. And she did look very important, dear. You know, one of those. She looked very, very important, this woman playing the piano. And there was another young lad there who was about, I reckon about 15, and he had a clarinet. And that sounded all right. I noticed before he started playing the clarinet, I thought he was chewing chewing gum. So if anyone knows, that little thing, I think he might have been doing something with that bit that goes in. Now, what is it? I think it's a reed. Don't they have to do something to that reed before they put it in the top of the clarinet? And so, ooh, 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 ooh. You recognise that? Anyone recognise that one? I'll do it again. Ooh, 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 ooh. What's that song? Is it Stranger in the Shore, that one? Anyway, he didn't play that. No, he just played along with the hymns. And he was very good, but he was chewing something. I thought it was a chewing gum, but I think it might have been something to do with a reed. Perhaps you'll tell me, put a little message up there and tell me what that was. So the mass came and went, and then I left there. And I had the unfortunate experience of having to go to Sainsbury's on the way back. Because I'd run out of vegetarian meals. I do buy quite a few corn products, corn and that sort of stuff. So I went in there, came out of there. And by the time I got back here, it was about 12 o'clock. So I put my dinner in the oven, lunch in the oven. And what did I have today? I keep buying these little packets of potatoes now. They're only a pound and you shove them in the microwave and they're done in 8 minutes with like herbs and a little bit of butter on. I can't remember what I had for dinner now. Hang on a minute. What was it now? No, that's gone. It doesn't matter anyway. So while that was in the oven, about 45 minutes, I did a bit of gardening. And I mowed the grass front and back. And then I noticed in my little slightly raised area that goes all along the side of the fence, there are hundreds of these little weeds. Now, I don't know if I mentioned these to you about a week ago. I noticed there was a lot of little weeds come up or plants in one area. And the thing is, I didn't know what they were. I didn't recognise them from something I planted. I just wondered if they had come from something else. So I was going to leave them and see what they became. But there were so many of them, and I thought I'm going to have to do something because they were taking over this whole area and they were spreading very quickly. So I pulled all those up and got my weed thing. You know, you just scrape it on the ground and it kind of cuts them all in half. So I did a bit of that, had my lunch, watched some television, and I've been watching an excellent programme, which I'll tell you about in a minute. Let's just do some of the messages coming up this evening, boys and girls. Hello to you all. Oh, hang on a minute. Blimey, there's loads of them. Jeez. Sorry, I've not kept up with you, have I? Hello to Paul Dale. A do-er. What is that? What is a do-er? What is a do-er? I don't know, Paul. What is a do-er? Hello to Alan Russell, who's with us this evening. Oh, hang on a minute. That's the wrong show. I'm reading your comments from a show 2 days ago. Do try and get... Will you not comment on shows that have just happened if I'm doing one? I don't know where I am half the time. You know that. Hang on a minute. Let's get back to this. Let's see if we can find... I thought to myself, what's that got to do with today's show? Hello to Rod Brown. Hello, Rod. Rod's with us this evening. Alan Russell says, good evening, Chris. Did you have a good night last night? No, they were not. I was on time, but they weren't. An hour and 5 minutes late. Shocking, dear. Shocking. Fantastic show, though. Nice people. But an hour late. Hello to Kim, who's with us up in Lincolnshire. Hello, Kim. Rod says I should probably stop for a while and watch. Chilling all night. You take it easy, Rod. You take it easy. Good afternoon, Vectis. Hang on another hour. Shania and I are on the ferry coming home. Yes, Vectis wasn't on the radio tonight. And you know, the funny thing is, Vectis, I arranged my show today so that I wouldn't clash with yours in the afternoon. And then you didn't do it. Cool, you can't win, can you? Gustav says, it's a mega field evening show, but it's happy hour at the Wetherspoons. There might be slight less people watching. We don't have Wetherspoons people watching this show, Gustav. How dare you? How rude. Joey's with us. Hello, Joey. Kieran. Hello, Kieran. Oh, little Kieran. It's been a while, hasn't it? Kieran used to run, used to be one of the managers at Central Station. It's about 2.5 years ago now, isn't it, Kieran? 3 years? Gosh, where's the time going? Dean's with us. Hello, Dean. Afternoon, Dean, or evening, Dean. Kevin's with us. Hello, Kevin. Paul McIlroy, who sends me some pictures of, I think they're ducks, are they? Why are you sending... You're not about to eat a duck, are you? I do hope not, Paul. You must become vegetarian, dear. You must... A lovely carrot surprise. You get some lovely, thick, round carrots ever so long. Ever so long. And you have one of those carrots, Paul, and you will be very, very satisfied. Very satisfied with a big, long, thick carrot. No need to sit there eating dead animals. God's sake, man. Mark's with us this evening. Good afternoon, Mark. Alan says, my daughter Megan is watching with me and she's laughing the way you're playing your flute. Ooh. Oh, no, that was the clarinet, dear. Do pay full attention. The clarinet, ooh, flute, right? Okay, flute, ooh, flute, ooh. What flute song? I know. Ooh, ooh. And clarinet, ooh. I know they sound very similar. Not in real life, the different instruments. Hello, Megan. Welcome, Megan. Mark Coburn's back. He's back from Pontins. He's been on holiday in Pontins, haven't you? Oh, my word. I used to go to Pontins all the time in the 70s. Wonderful place. Or at least it was then. I don't know what it's like now. They've been given a bit of a rough ride on programmes like Watchdog, haven't they? I remember them being quite a few times on Watchdog with, you know, dirty chalets and stained mattresses. Oh, God, how awful. I mean, it's bad enough getting on your own mattress that's been stained, but not someone else's. Have you got a stained mattress, Mark? Huh? Is your mattress at home stained a little bit? You know, it's OK. We're all adults here. We can all talk about these things. Now and again, you know, might get a little bit of a leakage out there. A little stain on there. It's no problem, is it? But not someone else's stain. Oh, have you ever checked? You know, I must admit, I've never done it myself. But have you ever checked in a hotel whether or not your mattress is clean? Mm. What an awful thought. Just imagine that. So you're in that hotel and Pontins, that it's been on Watchdog and I've seen it with my own eyes. And when someone's peeled back the sheets, oh, there's a great big stain on the mattress. Oh, no. Oh, God, no. What would you do? Would you just cover it up again and go back to sleep again? What was it like, Mark? Did you see any stains on the mattress at Pontins? And have you got one at home? Mark says he's off to sing, but will call in later. Feel free, Mark. call in later and we'll open the phone lines a little bit later on today, all right? Paul sends pictures of pigeons. Thank you, Paul. There's not many of them fly around here. There is actually a great big fat pigeon that lands in my garden looking around for bread. Rude it is, dear. Rude. Sticks its arse up in the air, flaps it towards me as it's waiting for its bread. Rude, that's what it is. Yes. Oh, talking of things in the garden, you know that little camera I've got out the front now? It, as I say, it picks out motion sense. It's motion sensing and picks things up. And the great big fat fox walked past my door the other day. It was about, I think it was about 2-3 o'clock in the morning. And it picks all this up. I get lots of cats setting off the camera. And it, you see, if I'm asleep, it records. Not on the camera itself. There's no recording in the camera. You know, so if a burglar was to come along and, oh, I think that camera's just got me. I just smash it off the wall and they won't have me. Incorrect. Incorrect, because the film is sent immediately, wirelessly, boys and girls. I like that word, wireless, don't you? It sends it wirelessly to some sort of data centre somewhere, and I just log in with my mobile phone. Would you like to see what's outside my front door now? I could just log in. It's wonderful. If you're wondering what I'm talking about, you've probably missed one or two of the shows. My Ring, R-I-N-G, my Ring doorbell, okay? And I can just, my mate's got one as well, Ronnie. I got him one for Christmas. And, I can't find the damn thing now. It comes as an app. Hang on a minute. There's my Ring app. There you are, Ring app. Okay. So I shall now log in to my front door, which is only downstairs, you know. I mean, just show you. And in a moment, the picture will come up of my front door. Okay. Just logging in now, boys and girls. And it's very, there you go. That's my front door. Now, obviously, it's a little bit dark to you. I know that. That's just because it's going sort of from phone to camera. Right, that's what's happening. That's on my front door. Can you see my green wheelie bin? That is standing by to be positioned a little bit later on, ready for the binman tomorrow. And it picks up any movement outside that happens and sends it straight to the data centre. Yes? So if a burglar smashes the thing off the wall before he attempts to enter me, enter my house, it's already been recorded. Too late, mate. We've got you on camera. Yes. So watch yourselves. I highly recommend one of those. Funny thing is, from the, it was Amazon that I bought it from. I order most stuff off Amazon, I must admit. And 2 days later, they sent me another link of another camera that you can connect to the same system. Okay, so you'd have two cameras. And this, it literally just, you put a couple of screws in the wall and stick up. No wires. So you're wondering how it's powered. They're battery operated. The battery lasts about anything between 3 and 6 months. And then you unscrew the little thing and charge it up again. Takes about an hour. Wonderful. Or you can wire them in directly if you want to. But the beauty of the battery thing, you know, I could go, because there's loads of trees around here. I could put one secretly on the tree and no one would know it was there. It would be very, very, it would just be our little secret. Someone said that to me once. Who was it said it can be our little secret? I can't remember now. But it would be our little secret, just yours and mine. There was a secret camera outside. Yes, a secret camera outside my house filming everything. So there's one out the front, the doorbell, and perhaps another one. And and it was £20 off the other one. And I was tempted. I was tempted, but I've held back, boys and girls. I've held back. Like, no, you've bought one thing for yourself this month. That's it. Don't be greedy. We mustn't be greedy, no. Mark says, is it? No, it's not that, Mark. Did it look like it was that? Thank you very much, Mark. I'm not on that same stuff that you're on, all these dating apps. You must be on every dating app there is under the sun, Mark. Is that right? God's sake, God knows what pictures you send to people, dear. Your bits and pieces hanging out all over the place. Good evening to Paul Dale, who's with us. There we are, Paul's there. I did read out one of your old messages earlier, Paul. I should remove that. I read out one of your messages earlier, Paul. That was from a show 2 days ago for some reason. All right. Good. Now, what was I telling you? So I told you about the garden. I went to sleep. Watched a bit of telly. Ah, yes, the television show that I watched earlier was recommended to me by my friend Wayne, who lives in London, in Canonbury. He's got an extremely large, no, I wouldn't say it's extremely large. His living room's very large, but he's got like a flat within his workplace. He lives in Canonbury, and from his what do you call it? You know, when you rooftop, from his rooftop, he's got a small rooftop terrace. You can see St. Paul's. St. Paul's. Can you just imagine living somewhere and you're in viewing distance and can see St. Paul's? As well as lots of air conditioning units from other people's roofs. But he lives there. And he recommended me to watch Britain on the Fiddle. Now, have you seen Britain on the Fiddle? Very, very good programme. Britain on the Fiddle. They've had three programmes on so far. Now, I've only watched the first one so far. And it's amazing what people can actually do. It really is. There's one bloke that was selling dodgy cigarettes. So when I say dodgy cigarettes, he's bought them from other places other than a normal shop, like a, I don't know, like a supermarket or a corner shop or something like that. He's bought them from airports, right? And here's the clever bit. You're thinking, well, how did he buy it from an airport? Did he go on holiday? No. No, he didn't. He found a way, and this is quite scary, I think, to actually produce a false boarding pass. And they showed you it on the telly. He made false boarding passes that could get him through the security in airports. So what he would do is come through the security. And this is one reason I don't fly. I can't bear all that security and the passports and the queuing up. Oh, it gets on my nerves. Oh, take your coat off. Put it in the tray. Take all the metal bits out. It gets on. And that's why I don't bother flying anymore. I hate it. I hate the, it's so inconvenient flying. Anyway, so he found the way to get through the passport and the security with this dodgy boarding. Because if you go through security, you can't just use your passport. You need the boarding pass to get onto a plane as well. Well, he printed his own off. I find that very scary. Very scary. So he would go in to the airports and then buy all these cigarettes from duty free. Now, of course, as you probably know, you're only allowed to bring back so many cigarettes, aren't you? I think. Although, isn't it with Europe, you can bring back as much as you want? Oh, I don't know now. I think it might be the case. I think if it's within Europe, you can bring back as many cigarettes as you want. I'm not sure about that. Although you have to, you know, you've got to convince them that they are for you. if you come through with 2 million cigarettes, I very much doubt that they're going to believe that you're going to smoke every light. Well, some people do. I suspect there's one or two of you over there smoking at the chain smoking at the moment while you're watching me. You know, am I making you nervous? I don't want to make you nervous. So he would go into the airport, go to duty free, buy all these cigarettes, and I don't think when you buy stuff from duty free, I don't think they're bothered about selling you more than that you're allowed. I don't think that's down to them. I'm 100% sure about that. I don't work in an airport. But it's when you come back through, you know, will you or won't you be stopped by, not security, is it customs? Will you or will you not be stopped? That's the thing. I'm sure there's one or two of you out there bought a little bit too much back before. You know, it's hit and miss whether you get nicked or not on the way through, isn't it? I don't bother. I don't smoke or drink, and I'm certainly not carrying stuff through for every other person, dear. God's sake, it's bad enough trying to carry your own bags through. So he would go into the airport, buy all these cigarettes, you know, quite legally buying them within the airport. But then he would come back out again without even going on a plane. Now, I don't know how he's done that because, as far as I know, once you've gone through that security bit, you can't go back out again, as far as I know. So somehow he found a way to get back out again. And he would go to his car or I don't know if he had a minicab or a friend waiting from outside with all these cigarettes, go home and sell them. He would sell them, instead of being like £9 a packet, they were £6 a packet. He would sell them for £6 a packet. And they interviewed him And he just didn't see anything wrong with it. You know, he said, well, I'm not murdering anyone or bringing drugs and guns through. All I'm doing is saving people a little bit of money on cigarettes. He didn't see anything wrong with it. You know, and the funny thing is, do you see anything wrong with that? Because I don't either. Yes, it is illegal. You're not allowed to do that. But we're not really bothered about it, are we? You know, we're not. You and I are not really bothered about someone, you know, saving a few quid on a few packets of cigarettes. Totally illegal. You're not allowed to do it. But it doesn't really bother the ordinary person. What does he do? Oh, he sells cheap cigarettes. Oh, okay. We're not bothered by that, are we? You know, murdered two people on the plane. I'd be worried about that. That would bother me. Bang him up for 10 years and throw away the key, yes. But selling a few cigarettes, we're not bothered. We're not really bothered about that, are we? And he was quite brazen about it, telling us exactly how he did it and all this business. So that's what he did. He's selling cigarettes tax-free. And I think it went to court and he had to pay. He'd spent all the money, you see. All the money that he'd made, he'd spent. So, of course, they fine him, I think, £38,000 or something. And he's got 6 months to play it. And he's like, well, this is ridiculous. He said, I haven't got £38,000 and all this. But he came across as being absolutely and totally convinced that he'd done nothing wrong. I'm sure you know people that, I don't know, I think they're allowed 200 cigarettes, aren't they? I think they're called a carton, aren't they? I mean, I don't smoke. You know when you get like 20, 20, 20, 20, 20, 20, 20. Is that a carton? I think that's a carton of cigarettes. I think you're allowed 200 from non-European places. And I know so many people that are bought through. I mean, not the amount he bought through, but like 400. Or if you're supposed to bring one litre of spirits, they might bring two or three. I've known people like that. And it doesn't bother you, does it? Totally illegal. Not allowed to do it. If you get caught, I think they take it off you or you have to pay excess duty, don't you? But it doesn't really bother me, does it? Does it bother you? No, of course it doesn't, you know. So he was convinced that bringing back these, I mean, thousands, thousands and thousands of cigarettes. But of course, he's defrauding the government out of their tax. And I think they said he owed. There was a few of them doing it. He wasn't the only one. I think it was something like £138,000 that they'd lost in tax revenue. And his portion of that was something was set at like £38,000 or something like that. And he's got 6 months to pay it. Well, I don't suppose you can find £38,000 in 6 months, could he? You know, but it doesn't worry you, does it? Would it worry you? Does that sort of thing bother you? Because it doesn't bother me. He's not killed anyone or anything, is he? Let's just do a few of your messages and we'll carry on the chatting about the show there. All right. Paul says, are you live now? Yes, Paul, the way you tell I'm live is if there is a little red thing somewhere on the screen. In some people's gadgets, it's on the left. Some people, it's in the middle. But there's a live, there's a, like a red live that tells you whether you're watching the show live or a recording, Paul, all right? So that's how it works there. All right? No, we haven't got the phone lines open yet, Blakey. All right? I haven't opened the phone lines yet. The trouble is, if I open phone lines too early, we don't get to the end of the story. That's the only problem. That's why I don't open them too early sometimes, okay? So that's that part of it. But the best one on there, as well, there were people claiming benefits here and abroad. There was one bloke coming over. He lived over here and he was claiming benefits in the UK and claiming benefits in, I think it was Belgium. And they caught him working in a restaurant in Belgium. Not a particularly well-paid job. Probably a lot lower paid than me, actually. He seemed to be just... he was either cooking or washing up or both. So he was doing that there. And they caught him. And he had defrauded, I think, housing benefit and all that. Something like £25,000. But the best one was this old bag who... she wasn't that old, probably a bit younger than me, actually. But she had three names. I'm just trying to think of her name now. Was it Angela? Oh, something like that. Angela or something like that. And she had three different names. claiming all this money left, right and centre. So they caught her and eventually they got her in. And she was just a compulsive. She was very good at it. She was a very good liar. So they're asking her, is your name so and so? She says, no, that's not my name. And she had the face, and she was a very convincing liar, I have to say. She was really good at it. Eventually they got her in, and she, honestly, she pretended to have a stroke. Oh, it was awful. And at first, you're watching this, and well, she is having a stroke. It looked to me like she was having a stroke. She was like, and she's shaking like this, like that. Until it cut to the council lady, who said she's done this three times before, pretended to have a stroke somewhere. I mean, you wouldn't do that, would you? Can you just imagine pretending to... I'd be worried, you know, that karma or God would then give me a stroke as punishment for pretending to have one. Oh, it's terrible. And she was really good at it. That's the worrying thing about it. Anyway, 3 years passed, and I'm just on the second episode. I'm going to watch that when I finish chatting to you tonight. So this is an ongoing story, this one. So I tell you how that gets on, but it was outrageous. You can't go around pretending to have a stroke or a heart attack or something like that, can you? Just so that people feel sorry for you? Dreadful, 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 dreadful. So that was her. And I think that's about it, really. Yeah. Yeah, that was that programme. So I watched that. Let's have a look. Let me just cross those bit out because I've chatted about those ones. So there we are. That was my TV viewing this afternoon. Went to bed, watched a little bit more of that programme, watched a little bit at the beginning of the second one. And here I am to chat away to you. I felt a show coming on. So here I am now to chat to you this evening, boys and girls, OK? Now, have you ever seen fraud? Have you ever perhaps experienced fraud or seen someone else do it? Perhaps it was as simple as, it's as simple as watching a bloke in your shoe. Now, we don't want names and addresses tonight, but have you ever seen fraud going on anywhere? And it can be any sort of fraud. Perhaps it was a mate who bought through an extra carton of cigarettes. Perhaps it was the bloke who comes around and fixes your roof. Cash in hand, mate. No, I don't take checks. Cash in hand only. You know, no bank details. Anything like that, then how about you tell me about that on the show tonight? I've got a few little bits and pieces to talk about for you to talk about and join in. Or you can ring in about anything else tonight. I'll go as well. Phone lines are open now. It's 020-8144-3477. That's my phone in number, OK? 020-8144-3477. If you've got Skype, you can Skype in. My Skype in number is, all one word, United Kingdom Talk, the Skype name. I say, so you can either call in on our local London number, 020-8144-3477. Or you can Skype in on United Kingdom Talk, all one word. However, if you're just happy to sit there and watch and join in and listen, then that's fine as well, OK? Thank you very much to those, as always, for those of you that have shared tonight's show on your wall. That is much appreciated as well. Kevin says, I saw the show as well. Thank you for the message, Kevin. Kevin sent me a little private message last night. How are you tonight? And I'm all right. So there we go. Thank you, Kevin. I saw that. Very good. Yeah, I think there's been three of them on so far, Kevin, but I've only seen the one so far. Yeah, so I'm looking forward to the rest of that. Alan says, yes, the live message is right above my head. If there's no red live... OK, if there's no red live thing in the corner, then you are indeed watching a recording of the show. OK, so that's how it is there. Good. What else have we got to talk about today? So we got that talking about fraud, if you've got any experience of fraud at all. How about the TV licence? Do you think the TV licence should be abolished? Now, I've heard this so many times. Being talked about on the radio and on the telly and that sort of thing. And I thought we could talk about that tonight. And I'll tell you why. I've always been a big supporter of the BBC. Indeed, I've got one of their badges here in front of me, as provided by the lovely Ray Reynolds. Okay, that may well be the closest I ever get to the BBC. But never mind, you know, I'd love my own little show on there, but that's one of those things. I've always been a supporter of the TV licence. I think once you go commercial and everything has to make money, I think that dumbs down a lot of television. I mean, there's enough crap television on as it is, you know. And people, I have to say, people love it. I hate it. The Only Way Is Essex, that Chelsea thing, that thing in Newcastle. There's one up north as well, isn't it? I don't know what that's called, you know. And it's all a bit. I'll just say it as it is. It's all about get your tits out and let's have a look at your ass. It's all a bit like that. You know, there is no talent from these people. They are just pretty people. And while they're pretty, they'll be on the telly. Do you really think you're going to see these people again in 10 years' time once they've got a bit fat like me? You know, once they've got a waist here, no, they'll be doing these little talk shows like that. But I don't think they're going to have anything to talk about. You know, the gorgeous blokes with the muscled tops and the tattoos. There's one been in the paper this week, hasn't he? He just beat up his girlfriend or something like that. And that's what these people are like. Dreadful programmes. Even like the celebrity stuff. I'm just not keen on it. Well, believe me, if the BBC ever had to become commercialised, I think you'd see a lot more of that on there. At the moment, they can make stuff that doesn't make too much money. It doesn't matter too much. And I've always been a big supporter of the TV licence fee. And it, fortunately for you and me, it hasn't gone up now for a few years, has it? It really hasn't. I think it's gone up this year, something about £4 or £5. I have to say, over the years, I thought it was going up exceptionally high. Every year it would go up, I think, quite a lot, really. And they had more and more money. I mean, there's a lot of fat at the BBC as well, I think. They could do with making a few less of the BBC Three programmes. You know, some of those are a bit iffy, aren't they, really? But I've always been a great supporter of the licensee, and I think it should continue. Then we can continue getting the quality stuff that we get. But... I was on my little Apple TV a few years ago. I've got the Apple TV, the first version, that was bought to me actually as a present from my mate Ron when he went to America a number of years ago. I've got the first one. So, I mean, I think it's been two or three since then. But that does me, because I like to stream stuff from my mobile phone. I've actually got it set up in my bedroom so I can stream stuff from the mobile phone directly to the television. On this Apple TV, there's all these different apps. You can watch, you can get Netflix through it, which I don't have any subscription television at all. I find watching the television Freeview, and I've got Freeview and Freesat. I don't believe in paying for subscription television. Although it's getting to the point where I sometimes look things now. Oh, I'd like to see that. Oh, it's on Amazon Prime or Netflix or something like that. At the moment, I'm getting enough stuff off Freeview and Freesat, so it's okay. But I can see the time where get to the point where so much of the good stuff is now on pay TV. If you're a sports fan, then I haven't got to tell you that, have I? Before pay television, this stuff was all free. Boxing Saturday night. Football, all day Sunday, cricket, tennis, all free, either on the BBC or on ITV. We never paid for this stuff. It just came all free. And the quality of the television was so much better. Less choice, which means people would be, the producers of television and the makers of television programmes would be fighting each other to make the best quality product they could possibly make, because if it wasn't quality, it wouldn't get on there. There wasn't the space. Now they're fighting to fit. Oh, quite honestly, why one of those cheapo TV companies hasn't signed me up yet? Well, the amount of crap that's on there, I don't know. But there you go. That's the way it is. You know, perhaps I'm not pretty enough. Not pretty enough. My nose is too long. A few too many wrinkles, perhaps. But while I was looking at this Apple thing, it comes up with films or TV shows. So I clicked on TV shows. And there I came across several BBC television series that had been on recently. The one in particular, Taboo. Now, you remember going back a few weeks now, I really enjoyed the TV show Taboo. Do you remember it? Set in the 1700s or something, 1800s, I think 1700s perhaps, or the 1800s. And it was about this this bloke who had like magical powers because he'd been in Africa and all that African magic stuff that they do, and he'd come across it. And he owned this island that the East India Dock Company wanted to get off him. First of all, they tried to do it nicely by offering money, but he wouldn't sell it. So they tried to do it nastily. Anyway, this series was on the telly and it was excellent. Now, in the past, you could go on the telly and watch it on the iPlayer. But I think you can still do that, but only recently after it finished. Now, I don't know what the time scale is, maybe a week, maybe a month. But once it's finished, it's gone. You know, the programme will finish on the telly. Then it'll come on the iPlayer for a period of time. It can only have been a couple of weeks. Because now it is available to buy on the BBC store. So if you didn't see it was on the telly, you can buy the entire series on the BBC store. I don't know how that quite works. Would you download it? You can't download it onto an Apple TV. I don't know how that works. Maybe you just buy it and then it keeps a note of your name and address. And so anytime you want to watch it, it's kept on a data server somewhere and you just click it. I expect it to be something like that. No physical CDs. No physical DVDs. You're just buying something to stream, I suppose. I'm not quite sure how it works. Anyway, so you want to buy this TV series? £28. £28. And I thought, that's a bit steep, isn't it? And remember, you're only just buying one TV series here. And I just feel that I've paid for it twice if I was to buy it. The first time around, I have, as you probably have as well, a TV licence. I've already bought that. $106. Well, I can look it up if you want. Let's see if I've still got that here. TV licence. Here it is. One moment, please. Is that it here? Here it is. Yeah. £145.50. That's my TV licence. You got one of those? £145.50. For years, television and radio, I think that's pretty good. And before you say that's a lot of money, you just work out how much Sky costs you a year, or BT Vision, or something like that. I'm so against all this pay television, I really am. But I pay that TV licence, and I expect to be able to watch anything that the BBC puts out. But no. Once it's been and gone, you have to pay for it now. And I think that's wrong. Now, I know they're short of money. Quite honestly, the people at the top could be doing with a bit of a pay cut at the BBC, couldn't they? And it's a bit slow. And some people say, you know, it's a little bit geriatric, the BBC, and it needs to modernise. But I don't see why I should pay again for something that I've already paid for out of my TV licence. And I object to that. I think the TV licences should stay. I really do. And I think once a show has been shown on the BBC, we should be able to watch it again at any time that we damn well please. Some of them turn up on YouTube. I don't know how that happened. Whether it's BBC that puts or someone ripped them off and shoved them up there. There's some very good old Doctor Who's on there. John Pertwee, Planet of the Spiders, is my favourite ever Doctor Who story. Must be about 40 years old now. Look it up. They got these big spiders. They are so unrealistic. It's unbelievable. They don't look real at all. And it's hilarious. Some of that programme is supposed to be, as a child, of course, I would have been scared, witless scared, seeing these giant spiders like that. Shaking. Yes, Doctor, give me the crystal. Unrealistic spiders, that's what they are. But I loved it. Now it's funny. It's very funny watching that. So give that one a go. And I can watch that. And I just don't see why I should pay twice to watch a programme. I mean, and £28 for one TV series. Yes, I know it costs millions of pounds, but I've already paid for my TV licence. What do you think? Do you think we should keep the TV licence or get rid of it? Do you think it's fair, you know, that the BBC charge again for programmes that we've already seen, we've already paid for? Then let us know. I'll stick a message there. I'll read it out. Or you can call in, boys and girls, 020-8144-3477. Just as always, I'm never reliant on phone calls. If you don't want to call in, that's fine as well. 020-8144-3477 or Skype in on United Kingdom Talk, OK? Hello to Elaine, who's with us. Sorry, I've got itchy nose here. Elaine in Israel is with us this evening. Evening, Elaine. I hope your radio show's doing very well. Do you know what? I could... I haven't got a tissue. 1 minute. I've got one in the bin, just a minute. Excuse me. I've got second-hand tissues in the bin. There we are. Elaine's with us in Israel. Joey says, get yourself a fire stick. Well, what's that then? What's a fire stick? I don't know what a fire stick is. That's an Amazon thing, isn't it? A fire stick? I'm sure that's an Amazon thing, a fire stick. Yes. Do you think the TV licence fee should stay there? Or do you think it should all be free and commercials? I've just got an incredibly itchy nose. Do you know, I think there's a little hair and it's irritating the inside of my nose. Do you get that? Oh, gosh. I'm like this quite often. People think I'm doing drugs up my nose. Oh, it's awful. Oh, sometimes a good blow helps it. From my nose, of course. I don't know what a fire stick is. You'll have to... someone ring in and tell me what a fire stick is, please. 020-8144-3477, Joey. Can you give me a ring? Tell me what that is. Alan says, what sort of music do you play on Saturday nights, Chris? Alan, it's not about the music on the Saturday night, really, in Central Station. It's about the cabaret. I'm just a warm-up person for the cabaret. OK, that's what I am. The music... there tends to be an older crowd in there, so I kind of stick to 70s and 80s in there. Sometimes 60s, sometimes a bit of easy listening. It's not really about dancing in there. It's a cabaret venue, so I'm just the kind of the warm-up man. I do a little bit of chat as well. All right? Yes. So we need to find out what... I don't know what a fire stick is. I'm sure it's something to do with Amazon, a fire stick. Elaine says, I'm not on the air tonight because my station manager's wife had a baby. What? So there's no programmes? Elaine, have they closed the station down for the night because the wife's had a baby? What sort of station is that? God's sake. Oh, how funny is that? How funny is that? Adam, hello, Adam. Adam the plumber's there. Who says, oh, shouldn't you be at church now, Adam? Or is that finished this evening? I thought, don't you go to church on Sunday night, Adam? He says, get rid of the TV licence and put product placement in a lot of their TV programmes now. Sort of thing where, you know, I could be paid vast sums of money just by having this fake hair in front of me. Yeah, you and I would have it just there, wouldn't I? They do that. Don't they do that now on The X Factor? And Britain's got no talent. There's no talent left. It's all dried up, dear. I think, do you know, I think I'm the only person with talent here in the UK now. I really do. Huh? Product placement. What sort of things could you see here as product placement? That's a good thing. Maybe I could get in contact with a few companies and have a few items up here. Can you suggest anything that should be up here around me or behind me to make a bit of money? Oh, dear me. Anyway, that's the TV licence. Well, that's three subjects so far. No one's calling in. You're not very interested tonight. Doesn't matter. You don't have to call in if you don't want to. Don't bother me. I just wanted to say, great shame, of course, our list of stars that we've been losing over the last year and a half now. Chuck Berry is now gone now. Chuck Berry, great artist. And I think it's fair to say that he brought the electric guitar to the front of the stage. Don't you think so? My most memorable song of his would be Johnny Be Good. I've had a few people do that sometimes at karaoke nights. Actually, does Johnny Key do that one? I think Johnny Key does that. You know, Johnny Boogan. And Roll Over Beethoven. Roll Over Beethoven! Well, you've got that guitar playing away, haven't you? Excellent, excellent. Chuck Berry, rest in peace and thank you for the music. Good. Now, we've got a couple of stories to do for you today, boys and girls. Are you a Neighbours viewer? Neighbours. Everybody needs good neighbours. Do you like Neighbours? Well, I used to like Neighbours. I stopped watching it years ago. Years and years ago. I liked it, or I was watching it when Helen Daniels was in it. Do you remember her? She died a number of years ago, but she was the granny. And I'll never forget, she came on the Wogan show, Terry Wogan show. And I was quite excited that she was going to be interviewed. But when he was interviewing her, what a blooming itchy nose. When he was interviewed, she wasn't a very good interviewee, so to speak. It was all a bit, yes, no, yes. You know, the conversation wasn't quite... I think Terry Wogan, who's also... He's been gone a year now, isn't he? Terry, our Terry Wogan. Our Terry Wogan. Oh, God, this blooming nose. I think he was having a bit of a hard time interviewing her. Do you remember the interview, anyone? Helen Daniels. So that's when I stopped watching Neighbours. Really, when she came out of the series. It's a long time ago now. Well, and of course that made the switch, didn't it? From BBC to ITV. Now, what am I going to do with my nose? Hang on a minute. Oh, dear. Oh! You know, a good sneeze would help, but I'm not feeling a sneeze tonight. Must be one of the first shows I've done for a long time when I haven't sneezed. Neighbours made the switch on BBC to Channel 5 because they got a bit greedy, didn't they? You find that people get greedy, don't they? Anyway, in today's Super Soraway Daily Mail, Neighbours could be axed after 31... It's been on 31 years! After 31 years on British television, after talks between the producers and Channel 5 reportedly stalled. So someone's got greedy again. They get greedy. They kill the goose that laid the golden egg. Do you know the amount of times I've seen people getting greedy? This is what happens. The classic Australian soap could be cancelled if broadcasters fail to agree to a new terms set out by the producers Fremantle Media. I thought they were English. Aren't Fremantle? Don't they own Thames Television now? Fremantle, I think. TV insiders claim negotiations over the show, which first aired in the UK in 1986, are in jeopardy, reported the Daily Mirror. A source said the renegotiation of the Neighbours Channel 5 deal has become very fraught and is in jeopardy. Channel 5 really want to keep the show, but the failure to reach a deal is being blamed on Channel 5's new American owners, Viacom. Who are refusing to sign off on the figures and not understanding the cultural importance of the show in the UK. Cultural importance of the show? what cultural importance is the show to us? That's a bit mad, isn't it, saying that? The popular soap moved from the BBC in 2008. Sure, it's been on 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15, 16. 9 years that's not been on the BBC. My God, where's that gone? Four. The popular soap moved from the BBC in 2008 after Fremantle Media asked the broadcaster to pay £300 million over 8 years, three times the show's usual fee. So they let it go. You know, and they just, people get greedy. If an agreement cannot be reached this time, there's a real danger the soap could disappear from British television. I just wonder how many viewers it's got nowadays on Channel 5. Because generally, once stuff moves on the BBC, it loses the viewers. But it has been on Channel 5 for 8 years now, so they must have a reasonable following on there. It was first screened by the BBC and 21 million viewers tuned into the peak in the 1990s. So you could be losing Neighbours. I've got the 12-inch single of Neighbours. Is it down here? Hang on a minute. It might be here somewhere. Hang on a minute. Just a minute now. Oh, God. No, it's not there. Is it there? Have I got that here? I can't see it, no. Somewhere... So, do you know, I've got racks of papers up there. I really need to go. I don't dare go up there. There'll be spiders and things on a show. That's probably why I sneeze so much. I've got shelves up there. Stuff hasn't moved from there for years. Honestly, the last time I had this room decorated, that's the last time I went up there. I want to look at those papers and just chuck stuff. Do you hang on to stuff all the time? Would you miss Neighbours? Would you miss Neighbours or perhaps Home and Away? You and me belong together. But they do. They just get greedy. They want more and more money for all this stuff. And a lot of places are just not willing to pay it anymore, are they? Shame, really. I haven't watched it for years. I wouldn't know who's in it anymore. Kevin says it was better when it was on the BBC. What is it? I think, Kevin, that's because you were younger and I was younger then. We used to like it then. It doesn't interest me now, really, watching Neighbours. I don't watch any of the soaps. Unless you can include Casualty and Holby City as soaps. Because I do watch those two. They're about the only two things that I watch now that are like regular, every week type things, you know. Alan says he was 31 years ago that started. It's unbelievable, was it? Paul says, Mrs. Mangle, was she in Neighbours? Yes, she was. Mrs. Mangle, with black hair. I think she's gone as well now. I think a few of them have died. Shame, really. Graham says, I know a person who had 4 wigs and changed them to make it look like his hair grew. And then he'd go back to the short one and start again. Oh, is that someone we know, Graham? I don't know. Do you think I should have a wig? No, I don't know about that. I don't think I'd like a wig. I mean, what, you know, if you've got a wig on and you sneeze, does it kind of flying off of your head again? That's the worry about that. Now, are you ready for your new speeding fines? Eh? It's coming. Oh, it's coming. British motorists who are getting caught speeding could end up forking up to £2,500. That's gone up a bit, isn't it? They're desperate for the money. They won't catch me. I don't speed anymore. I drive on the motorway 55 miles an hour, I do on that motorway. Lorries overtake me sometimes. Don't worry, I'm always on the inside lane, not in the middle. I'm not a middle lane hogger like some of them on there. Cool, you should have seen some of them speeding last night on the motorway. What was it? Was the M4. Now, I did say at the beginning of the show that was closed. What I meant was the first part of it was closed, so I joined it further along. No, I beg your pardon. It was the M40 I took last night. Oh, I don't know how fast some of these cars are going past me in the inside lane. And there was one bit where there was someone on the inside lane. He was going even slower than me. So I went to the middle to overtake him. And I saw in my mirror someone coming up in the fast lane. He was only in the fast lane. And as he was going so fast, as he went past me, now, it was like a... what do you call it? A very fast car. Oh, what do you call that? A performance car. It was some sort of performance car, like a BMW or something like that. And I spotted him in my rearview mirror coming up really ever so fast. And as he went, and I've got a big car. My car's large, okay? As he come past me, I could actually felt the wind of the car go like that. Jeez, why don't these people get caught? You guarantee if I go like 72 mile an hour, there'll be a blue flashing light behind me. Mad people. Anyway, currently the maximum possible fine for driving above the speed limit is £1,000. I didn't know that. But the up limit is due to be hiked by 150% from April the 24th. From the date, offenders can be charged up to 175% of their weekly income if they are caught speeding. Fines are divided into 3 bands, which I didn't know, A, B and C, which correspond to how serious the offence is. So I have been done speeding before. I think I've got 3 points on my licence or something like that. And this is me. I would be classed as a band A. So drivers caught at speeds up to 10 mile an hour over the limit are classed as band A. So that that's always been me, actually. I don't think I've done anything more than a band A. With band B, fares relating to offences where motorists were clocked at 11 miles and up to 21 miles an hour over the limit, which is actually quite a lot. You know, if you've got a 30 mile an hour limit, that means you've done 51 miles an hour. which on a small street in London is just ridiculous. And I've seen it. I've seen people doing 50, 60 mile an hour in a 30 mile an hour zone. I have. It's a shame you can't take pictures of these people and just send them in somewhere, couldn't you? You know, if we could have like a on our mobile phone, like a speed camera app, that would be quite good, wouldn't it? I mean, you can take a picture of a car. You don't know how fast they're going. If you could take a picture of a car and it pops up in the corner, you know, 76 miles an hour, and just send it into the police, that would put a stop to it. That's what we need to do, dear. The banned sea offenders face between fines of 125% and 175% of their weekly wage, which could see the wealthiest motorists being slapped with penalties close to £2,500 limit, which is, of course, you know, it's going to be the wealthy people that own these performance cars, isn't it? You know, like the top of the range BMW or the Range Rovers, things like that. I mean, I couldn't afford some. Well, I could if I sold a house, I suppose, but I wouldn't want one. I don't think I'd want a car like that. You know, parking something like that outside like a pub. You know, you're just asking for it to be damaged, aren't you, when you've got a really big, big posh car like that. You know what people are like. So I don't think I'd like one of those. The most serious of this category, C, applies to drivers exceeding the speed limit by more than 21 mile an hour. So that is quite a large increase, isn't it? But, I doubt that having a fine of £2,500 to someone who earns all that money isn't going to make a slight bit of difference, is it? It's really not. They're just going to pay the fine and carry on. Doesn't bother them. Especially some of these foreign cars that come over from Saudi Arabia. You know, owned by very, very hideously rich people. And they got loads of money. It don't bother. Oh, £2,500, I just write a check. They're not bothered. Not bothered. Just write the cheque and carry on as they are. Doesn't bother them. Doesn't affect them. So I think the only way to deal with people who do drive at those speeds, I think a prison thing is the only way, isn't it? How else are you going to stop people doing that? And the people on their mobile phone. Oh, I saw another one last night on the way in, watching the television on the dashboard on the mobile phone. Madness. Absolute madness. They've got that's several people I've seen now watching the telly on their mobile phone. They got the mobile phone on the windscreen like that, and they're watching the telly. Jeez, why don't these people get caught? Shania's back home now. Hello, Shania. She's back home. I'm not going to be here much longer, Shania. I'm getting hungry now. I got nice spaghetti arabetta today. Thank you very much. Yes, please. Wholemeal spaghetti. Not that I didn't have wholemeal spaghetti in Waitrose the other day. Most disappointing. Hello, Shania. Kevin said, I'm glad I didn't drive. Did you never drive, Kevin? Oh, it's not that necessary. It depends where you live, really, doesn't it? You know, if you've got a good transport system where you are, no need to drive. But I do like driving. I've got an automatic vehicle now, and it's so much easier than driving one with gears. I wish I'd done it years ago. I do. Alan says you can go up to 10% over the speed limit. That's kind of correct, Alan. The 10% is there for your speedometer not being quite right. So, if the speed limit is 50 mile an hour and you do 60 because you think that 10% is there. Sorry, if it's the speed limit's 50 mile an hour, and you think you can do 55 because you get 10%. But what, you've left no room of error for your speedometer then, have you? You know, that's incorrect. That 10% is for a problem with your speedometer. Now, the police could pull you over and then take your car in. You're doing 55 mile an hour. They could take your car in and then test it and see what the speedometer is. And if it is reading correctly, then you have actually done 5 mile over the speed limit and you'll get done, mate. So no, that's incorrect. Incorrect. It's no law that says you can do up to 10% over the speed limit. That 10% is for errors in your speedometer. Because, I mean, the manufacturer. And besides, you know, if you do, I think, to be honest, the speedometers are probably set in the manufacturer's favour. So, you know, when you see the advertising and all that, it's does 60 mile an hour or something like that. And I bet if it did 60, you're probably actually doing 55 anyway. something like that. So I wouldn't worry too much about that, all right? Chris, try the spray. I can't try the hairspray, Kevin. The reason is it's very fumey. And it's a very, very powerful fumes come off this, unfortunately. So I've got to do it outside. And I'm waiting for a time when my mate can come round. And then I'll try it out. And we'll do that as a recorded show, OK? We'll do that as a recorded show. Yeah, Kevin says so. The bus does him or the train. So there we are. All right, boys and girls, we're going to wrap up now. Let me do today's birthdays. Oh, I just wanted to read out some messages from yesterday's show. I'm very, very happy to report that JoAnna has received her mug in the post. JoAnna writes, "Guess what, Mr. Reardon? I went to the post office and there were a few packages my mailman didn't deliver because he knew I was in hospital. These packages were tagged as fragile." Ah, yes. You look at this. Just a minute. That'll be one of these. One minute. You got this, didn't you? Here's the sticky tape, my fragile. I should put this around myself because I'm a little bit fragile. I'm a bit fragile myself. You got that, didn't you, on the package? And she says, so he didn't deliver. Anyway, I finally received my United Kingdom Talk mug through the post and it was undamaged and in one piece. I'm so glad to finally receive it. Thank you, dear. Well done, JoAnna. I'm glad it got to you. I'm glad you got the unbroken one, darling. That has pleased me no end. Well done. And Simon says, I agree, you should be the new Doctor Who, Chris. Instead of Daleks saying exterminate, they could say chop, chop. Chop, 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 like that, couldn't they? Yes. You could have JoAnna as your glamorous assistant. Your bedroom could be the TARDIS. Your first episode could have guest appearances from your Central Station regulars. It would be a leaky TARDIS with water coming in. Roy could ring Adam the plumber and sing, "There's a hole in my TARDIS, dear Adam." And Mary could sit there stroking her pussy cat. Then when the hole is fixed, Ice could present Adam with a cake and the finale would have to be the Tony Blackburn singing on the radio. What do you think? I love it, Simon. Simon, I think that's the most excellent message that you've ever sent me. Thank you very much. I love it. Yes, indeed. Thank you, Simon. That's excellent, my friend. That's excellent. What an excellent idea it really is. Today's birthdays then. Let's say happy birthday to Louise and Karen. Louise and Karen, 53 years old tonight. Hello, my darling. All right. Come and sing us a song again soon. Happy birthday to Stuart J. Skinner. To Khuram. Where are you? Where have you been, Khuram? 30 years old today. Happy birthday, Khuram. I'm missing you. You haven't been to sing for me. Where have you been? You and Peter. Is Peter? Is it Peter? Yeah, Peter. Where's Peter and you? Come on, make an appearance soon. Happy birthday to Ken Ledster-Leray, 49 today. Carl Summers is 29 today. An excellent moustache there, Carl. Excellent. Alex Hill was 35 today. Gina DeCarl, it's her birthday today. John Mercer, hello, John. John Mercer's birthday today from Tameside Radio. Happy birthday, John. And Tony Tansley is 63 today. Happy birthday, Tony. Here comes the song. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday. Happy birthday. Happy birthday to you. All right, I know it's late tonight, you know, but we got the like to get the birthday song in, even if it's like, you know, only 3 hours left of a Sunday now. Thank you very much for watching and listening to the show tonight, boys and girls. I'll see you again very soon. It's Sunday night. I've got a night off now, so I'm going to go and watch some more of that what was that program, Britain's on the Fiddle, and I've got Casualty to watch. But first I shall disappear into my kitchen to do my nice spaghetti I can never say the words. You know the stuff I mean. The spicy spaghetti bolognese. Very tasty. Followed by some lovely strawberry angel. Or shall I do the butterscotch one today? I can't decide. No, I'll do the strawberry. Strawberry angel delight. You enjoy the rest of your Sunday, and I'll see you again very soon. Bye-bye now.